Good morning and welcome back to Community Couch Time. I'm Ms. Guadalupe Carrasco Cardona, and I'm going to come to you daily with topics that we should be talking about, things that are happening globally, things that are happening nationally, things that are happening in our community, but most importantly, things that we oftentimes don't talk about. And the question is, why shouldn't we? And the thing that's really amazing is that we get to share our perspectives with another amazing human being, Ms. Tiffany Wallace.
Good morning, great minds and good people. I'm Ms. Tiffany Wallace, and thank you for having me for Community Couch Time. Now, let's start the discourse.
Good morning and welcome back to Community Couch Time. Today's going to be a little bit of a lonely day. We don't have Ms. Wallace, but she'll be back for the next episode. In honor of the month of Halloween, right before Día de Muertos, I want to kind of continue the theme that we started with Ms. Wallace, who shared with us the great Nina Simone version of Pirate Jenny. And so I'm going to do that with a story that many of you are very familiar with, and that's the story of La Llorona, right? And so I'm going to quickly just like go over La Llorona, and then I'm going to share a little bit of a backstory to La Llorona. So many of us have grown up with, you know, a body of water that is nearest that we all have heard of La Llorona having drowned her children. And now she spends all of eternity crying out for her children, right? Mis hijos, mis hijos. And so that is a story that many of us were actually disciplined with, right, by our parents. Our parents were like, if you don't behave, La Llorona's gonna come get you. And so at least for me, that was the way that it was used. And I know that I have many friends and family members that have had their own versions of La Llorona from wherever it is that they grew up. And so historically, it comes from when the Spaniards came to Mexico, and then eventually other parts of the Americas as well. They, in some cases, took wives, right? They had wives that were indigenous women, and the children of the Spaniards and the women were oftentimes not accepted by both the Spanish community, the European community, and also the indigenous community, because of, you know, eventually what had happened with the invasion of the Spaniards into Mexico, Central America, Latin America, right? And so the story goes that you know, since her kids were not wanted, that she killed them. But I'm going to read to you a short story that actually proves that she did not kill her children. Okay, and so let's enjoy this in honor of Halloween, and then we can have a little discussion about what it means later. Okay, so this short story that I'm going to read to you is called "The Children of La Llorona." A woman wails through the ancient streets of Mexico City, Tenochtitlan. Where are my children? Where might they be? Who is she? And where are her children? People ask, looking at this brown woman as though she has lost her mind. Lost her mind? Maybe. But what is not in doubt is that she has definitely lost her children. She knows not where they are. She is the woman who bore the children of a conquistador, turned aristocrat, who purportedly loved her. He said he did. I love you, my India, till the end of time. She wails every night because one day, when his European bride-to-be stepped off a ship from across the great ocean, he banished the native woman and their children from the city. In those days, Europeans did not consider native peoples equal for human, not truly human. In those days, in these days, get out of here. Don't ever enter or even look at the city again, he admonished her and her children. Devastated, the native woman drowns her children in a nearby river. Since then, she has wailed through the streets looking for them. There are other and older variations of the story, but this is the most widely known version. Some say it is but European lies, an effort to dishonor and cast a stain upon La Llorona. an effort to blame an Indian woman for the death of her children. It is also an effort to portray her children as illegitimate children, as fatherless children. Even to this day, many peoples from the villages and pueblos that have existed long before Europeans came to the Americas say the story is incorrect, that it was twisted, that La Llorona never actually drowned her children, that they were swept away by a raging river as she bathed them. All the versions agree that no bodies were ever recovered. That's why she wails. Not because she drowned her children or because they never received a proper burial, but because they may still be alive somewhere downstream or upstream. Where are my children? Where might they be? Today, if one goes outside the ancient city of Tenochtitlan, Mexico City, in any direction, people of the surrounding villages and towns report on an occasional sighting and say that her screams can still be heard in the wind. Certainly, her story has not been forgotten. For many centuries in the European accounts, she has been seen as an evil or deranged woman. Children are warned, si no te portas bien, se te va a aparecer la Llorona. If you don't behave, la Llorona will come and take you away. But today, no one in the nearby villages sees her that way. Quite the contrary. They recount that it was she and she alone who cared for her children before and after she was abandoned, and that the conquistador cared about nothing except slandering her and the children. They are all lies, the villagers say. She was a good woman. It is she who took care of her children. It is he who betrayed them. It is he who abandoned them and who banished them from the city. There are many stories and even legends about her, but there are also stories about the children. Most of these have been lost to history, or they have never quite made it to the printed page. Only the wind retains the children's memory and remembers their story. It is said that the children actually survived and left many tracks as they went from village to village looking for their mother. There are some stories that are heard throughout the continent, especially near rivers or other bodies of water, even in what is today the United States or El Norte. This story, some say, was first told during the years of war and famine, a time when the conquistadores were laying waste to the countryside and were busy exterminating the continent's original peoples. It was a time of depopulation. It was a time of unprecedented forced migrations, peoples turned into refugees, fleeing from the merciless violence. It was a time of widows and a time of orphans. It was a time of suffering and a time of wailing. It was a time of disease and a time of suffering. During these years, the children of La Llorona were taken in and raised mostly by indigenous mothers and grandmothers. Originally, they knew not who these brown children were, yet later they began to hear the stories, the lies, spread by those who bore swords. The mothers and grandmothers had their own children to raise during these difficult times, but collectively, they took these lost children in, cared for them as best they could, sometimes giving them care and sustenance when there was nothing to give, even when their own children and grandchildren went without. When these children grew up, they too heard the many conflicting stories. Our story is that the children weren't actually sired by the conquistador, that the actual father was killed by the conquistador. Due to jealousy, the conquistador killed the actual father. Many villagers affirm that the actual father never abandoned his own children, that he was separated from them by sword so that the conquistador could steal their beautiful mother. That's what everyone agrees about, that she was beautiful. That she was beautiful before she lost her husband and her children. That she was beautiful until she lost her mind. It is true, they say. She was the most beautiful woman from Tenochtitlan, the most beautiful woman in the entire valley of Anahuac. For many years, her children lived but were rejected by all, treated as if they'd been contaminated simply because they were born. The Europeans had spread rumors that she was but a woman of the streets and that her children were illegitimate mongrels. They wanted nothing of these brown ones. In many of the villages too, the children were rejected because they were seen as bastard children, the product of rape. But the native mothers and grandmothers who took them in knew not the word illegitimate or mongrel or the concept of bastard children. They accepted them as family. Some of you bear the marks and even the color of the conquistadores, but in most of you, we can see your mother. We can also see the mark of your indigenous fathers. But to us, all of you without distinction are the children of the Creator, and we recognize you as our children. The mothers and grandmothers raised the children of La Llorona to love their mothers and to love themselves. Yet over the years, her children also began to believe these stories told about them, as they had forgotten who their mother actually was. The more they heard the false stories, the more they despised her. Eventually, they rejected the mothers and grandmothers that raised them, rejected their teachings, rejected themselves, and often turned ferociously against their other relatives. Despite this, the mothers and grandmothers accepted them, especially when they would not accept themselves. Even though you may forget who raised you, even though you may one day come to hate us, the love of a mother is unconditional and eternal. It is said that nowadays, it is not La Llorona who is looking for her children, but her children who are looking for her. Where is our mother? Where might she be? They ask. In later years, there were many other lost children like them, despised and rejected by all, because it continues to be a time of famine and often a time of drought. Many of these children continue to move on, often never being able to settle in but one place. It is said that today, one can see them braving mountains and deserts and even crossing rivers, still looking for their mother and a place to call home. Many never quite make it, their bodies often claimed by the hostile desert, mountains, and treacherous rivers. It is said that if they ever find their mother, no matter how long they've denied her and denied themselves, if they honor her and come to her in a good way, she will always embrace them and they will always have a home. This is the story of the children of La Llorona. Where are my children? Where might they be? Where is our mother? Where might she be? Where do we belong? Where is our home? And that is the children of La Llorona, which can be found at the end of Our Sacred Maíz is Our Mother, a book written by Dr. Cindy Rodriguez. And so I really chose it because it's a beautiful story that takes the story that we've been told of La Llorona and sort of turns it around. And so for Community Couch Time Daily Journal, there are many questions that would be so exciting to respond to and also to have a discussion about. But for this Community Couch Time Daily Journal, my question for you is, what is your Llorona story that your family shares? Or what is the horror story that your family shares? And what is the lesson that you get from that story? Thank you, Inlakech. Have a great rest of your day.